Hello and welcome to the TI Precision Labs discussing the key parameters and specifications in RF PLLs and synthesizers. In this video, we'll discuss the definition of these key parameters and specifications as well as how to use them in an actual design. If you understand these key performance parameters, it will go a long way in helping achieve a clean and smooth system PLL design implementation. Before we go to discuss the key parameters and specifications, let's do a very quick PLL review. First of all, where is the loop in the phase lock loop system? The loop is here. Most key parameters are therefore related to the end divider, VCO, phase detector frequency, and loop filter. Second question, what needs to be phase locked? The purpose of the PLL is to phase align the signal from the R divider and the feedback signal from the end divider. Okay, the last question. How does one use a PLL synthesizer? What do we need to do? All that is needed is to carefully design the loop filter in order to meet system phase noise, lock time, and spurs requirement. To achieve this goal, we need to have an understanding of the key parameters and specifications of a PLL synthesizer. They are phase detector frequency, FPD, charge pump current, VCO gain, PLL and VCO noise, spurs, as well as lock time. In TI.com, we have an online tool called Clock Architect, which can help find the total system's clock solution, as well as loop filter design and simulation. If you have issues with the internet, no problem. Platinum Sim, which is an offline tool, can help with that. Let's look at the PLL noise first. PLL has three major noise sources. Flicker noise, sometimes called 1 over S noise because its noise power is inversely proportional to the frequency. The next major noise source is the PLL noise floor, the so-called figure of merit, FOM. You may hear it called flat noise because, as you can see in the plot, its frequency response is a flat line. Source data for these two noise sources are usually found in the datasheet. Typical 1 over F noise and figure of merit are better than minus 120 dBc per hertz and minus 230 dBc per hertz, respectively. These two noise sources basically determine the performance of a PLL, but they are not configurable. The last noise source comes from the PLL end divider. The end divider will increase the noise floor by about 20 log N. This is one of the reasons why a fractional N PLL is more popular. With fractional N, you can have some flexibility to use a smaller N value. When all these noise sources are added up, we've got the PLL in-band noise. Please note, the example data presented here does not include the frequency response from the loop filter. The phase detector in a PLL is working at a rate equal to the reference clock frequency divided by R. The phase detector compares the phases of the signals coming from the R divider and the N divider, and then creates an error signal to the charge pump. It's the rising edge of the R divider signal that triggers the phase comparison. Remember that in the early time we said it was a smaller end divider value is desired because that reduces the PLL in-band noise. To achieve this goal, we should set the phase detector frequency higher. We should use a higher frequency reference clock or even bypass the R divider. Most of the modern PLLs today have a reference clock doubler in front of the R divider. In cases a higher frequency reference clock is not available, the doubler can help boost the phase detector frequency up higher. Following the phase detector is a charge pump. The charge pump will either sink or source a constant current every time it is turned on. While that current amplitude is a constant, the turn-on time is a variable and is dependent on the phase difference between the signal from the R divider and end divider, so it's kind of a pulse width modulation operation. Charge pump current can usually be configured by software in several different steps, each step around 100 microamps to a few milliamps depending on the part. A higher current is necessary to make a wide loop bandwidth. A smaller current can reduce phase detector spurs. In some cases, a smaller current is intentionally set so that for the same loop bandwidth we can use a smaller capacitor value in the loop filter. Here the picture shows a typical LC resonant oscillator. A variable capacitance diode, or its most popular name, a Varactor diode, is being used to form part of the resonant circuit. As a result, the oscillator frequency is tunable. The loop filter in a PLL system transforms a current source from the charge pump to a voltage source. This voltage will apply to the Varactor diode in a VCO and therefore change the VCO frequency plus or minus 10% to 15%. In order to support a wider tuning range, modern PLL synthesizers usually have several VCOs on a single chip. VCO gain, or KVCO, quantifies the rate of VCO frequency change versus the applied control voltage V-tune. Because the characteristic of the Varactor is not linear, KVCO can vary between the lowest and the highest possible VCO frequency. Typical KVCO values can vary between a few megahertz per volt to more than 100 megahertz per volt, depending on the part and the VCO architecture, along with what output frequency you're at. VCO phase noise plays an important role in a PLL system. It affects the closed-loop, far-out phase noise. If the VCO is being used as a local oscillator of a radio receiver, the far-out phase noise will affect receiver performance, such as adjacent channel selectivity, reciprocal mixing, blocking performance, etc. The Q factor of an oscillator determines its phase noise, and the higher Q means better phase noise. We define phase noise as the single sideband power difference between the carrier and an offset normalized in a 1 Hz bandwidth. Phase noise is expressed in how many dBc per Hz at what Hz offset. It's important to specify the VCO frequency when we talk about phase noise. We can't compare the phase noise of two VCOs having different frequencies directly. For example, we should say minus 121 dBc per Hz at a 100 kHz offset at 2.1 GHz carrier. Spurs are unwanted signals that appear at a regular spacing alongside with a carrier. Spurs could affect system performance and may lead to violating regulatory requirements on radiation. Let's do a quick overview on what kind of spurs there are. Phase detector spurs, as it implies, they are created by the phase detector. Fractional spurs are unique to fractional NPLL. The spur frequency is equal to the fractional portion of the end divider times the phase detector frequency. In some cases, subfractional spurs may be bigger than the fractional spurs. The subfractional spurs appear at 1/2 or a quarter of the fractional spur frequency. Phase detector spurs and fractional spurs are generated from the PLL, so in theory, they can be improved by adjusting the loop parameters or loop bandwidth behavior. Crosstalk spurs are somewhat tricky and not easy to deal with. One of the reasons, the spurs are usually close to the carrier. Another reason is the degree of crosstalk is somewhat unpredictable. Spurs are a deep topic in RF synthesizer design. Among these many types of spurs, phase detector spurs are more manageable by design in general. Crosstalk paths include crosstalk between phase detector and output, reference clock and output, as well as the reference clock and VCO. Among these many types of spurs, in general, it's better to keep those below minus 70 or minus 80 dBc if possible. Spurs are a deep topic. It is left to another training video to discuss spurs in more detail. In a closed-loop environment, when we change the VCO frequency, it takes some time for the loop to settle down to the new frequency. This transition is called lock time. Lock time can be fast or slow, depending on the PLL loop bandwidth. In general, a wider loop bandwidth reduces the lock time. The lock time can be estimated as 4 divided by the loop bandwidth. For example, if the loop bandwidth is 1 kHz, then the lock time is approximately equal to 4 milliseconds. We've gone through the key parameters in RF PLL synthesizer. Now it's time to see how they can be applied in a loop filter design. Shown here is the interface of the offline design tool, Platinum Sim. For a given VCO frequency, the chosen phase detector frequency will determine the end divider value. As we've seen before, a smaller end is desirable in order to reduce the noise in the PLL. Charge pump current can be involved in finding the correct passive loop filter component values. In a modern synthesizer, charge pump gain is usually configurable. VCO gain is also required in the calculation of the loop filter components, but unlike charge pump gain, VCO gain is something the end user usually can't control. It's basically determined by the VCO architecture. VCO phase noise is not required in the loop filter design, but it's necessary in order to find out the overall closed-loop PLL phase noise. The far-out phase noise of a closed-loop PLL system is usually determined by the VCO phase noise. You can upload a VCO noise profile to enhance the simulation. On the contrary, the PLL noise will determine the close-in phase noise. We have seen now how the key parameters are implied in a loop filter design. This concludes the video. Thank you for watching. Please test your knowledge of the material with a simple 5-question quiz to wrap up. If you need more information or technical resources on TI clocks and timing products, please visit ti.com and type in /clocks. Well, the first one is false. VCO phase noise determines the far-out phase noise of a closed loop. Nope, that's not right. The second one is true. That's why fractional end is more popular than integer end because it's possible to make the end divider smaller. The phase detector is generally triggered by the rising edge of the R divider, so in general, the duty cycle of the reference clock is not really important. Turn on time of the charge pump. My answer to the first question is no, false. The VCO phase noise determines the far-out phase noise of the closed loop. Second one is true. It will increase the PLL noise. That's why a fractional N can help, because it reduces the N value. Third one, it's false. The phase detector is triggered by the rising edge of the R divider in general. So the duty cycle of the reference clock is not really important. The turn-on time of the charge pump is proportional to the phase difference from the R and N divider. When it's small, the charge pump will turn on only a tiny amount of time. The phase detector spur frequencies are predictable because they are equal to the phase detector frequency, so the last one would be false.